Hello, and welcome back to the DVD Bunker. I'm Brian. This is Matt.
Hi, Brian.
How's it going?
Great, buddy. Great.
I'm reeling still, though.
Yeah?
I mean, they're in the future. When you're watching this, it's been a couple weeks.
That's
You've had some
true.
Time to process. But here in the present, we are still reeling from the tragic and unexpected death of Bill Paxton.
Yep.
We're, of course, wanted to do a tribute show. You know, usually we're just skimming through, whatever, any old movie in my collection to try to find something. But this week we knew we had a purpose, and I wasn't going to use Bill Paxton's death as a bullshit way to get aliens on the show.
Appreciate it.
We all know that Aliens, the James Cameron director's cut of Aliens, is my all-time favorite. This would have been a perfect way to exploit the death of Bill Paxton. I'm not going to do it, though. I'm not doing that. I didn't want to spend too much time talking about his filmography because that's, obviously the guy is iconic in, it was a character actor and like verged into leading man territory.
Yep.
He had some hits there and then, and was successful on television. And, we got to shout out a few. We said Aliens, True Lies, Weird Science. We just talked.
Yeah, we're talking him up in Weird Science.
Yeah.
Complaining.
Well, where our only complaint was there was not enough Bill Paxton.
Yeah.
That was the only thing that we had to say about it. Obviously, Tombstone's a big one for me. Although I don't think I'll ever be able to watch Morgan's death scene again. Now it's like I'll just be have to fast forward till just get to Kurt out into the rain. There, let's just get him out. Get him out in the rainstorm. Obviously one of the only two actors to be killed by an alien, a Predator, and a Terminator.
Yep.
Him and Lance Henriksen. So, lots of accolades, lots of great work. We could do a whole show about just tributes to his career, but we're going to focus specifically on a 2001 his directorial debut, Frailty.
I did not know he directed this.
Yes,
wow, great.
This was his directorial debut. I remember always being aware of this though, when it was coming out, and that Bill Paxton directed it, and obviously stars in it. He did go on to only direct, one other movie.
Okay.
He did For Love of the Game in 2005. Greatest Game Ever Played in 2005. It's a golf movie with Shia LaBeouf.
I never saw it either.
But I always, from the first time I saw it, I really enjoyed it. I've, talked to some people. I was happy when he passed. Not that he passed, but that I heard this getting brought up almost immediately.
Really?
I expected to kind of, obviously we all knew we were going to see the list of Bill Paxton movies, the classics, but I was really glad that people remembered this, and so I figured perfect time to talk about it. It was probably on the bunker list anyway, to be honest with you.
Yeah, when you sent me that text and asked me, I don't even remember what the other one you sent was, because I saw this and I was like, oh yeah, I love
Club
that,
Dread.
Can't wait,
Club Dread.
Dread, yeah, which
Club
this
Dread.
Says he features more than this. I feel like he's in Club Dread a ton.
He's definitely
either.
Supporting, the reason I wanted to, Club Dread was my other one, was it a rare, fully comedic performance
him. Yeah, true that.
Aside from Chet, I guess you would say, but, he's a funny, he was good at playing the funny guy in, action movies.
Yeah.
He was the funny guy in True Lies, he was the funny guy in Aliens, but as far as, a straight comedy, that was one of the only times I can think of that he played that.
Absolutely.
And he's just got some really great moments in that. Once we decided we weren't doing that, I watched it. I was like, oh, good, I'll watch Club Dread then. I'm like, sweet. I did want to say, before we talk too much more about, we should probably throw up a spoiler alert for Frailty.
Yeah.
Because this is one of those ones that you should watch and experience without knowing anything. So if you've never seen it, just put us on your watch later, go watch Frailty, and then come back and check us out. You won't hurt my feelings. I'd much rather you know the movie so that we don't ruin it for you. It's got a lot of cool stuff and a lot of cool ideas. And yeah, I want you to experience that the way we did the first time.
Agreed.
So, with that out of the way, I'll talk the plot just a touch.
Okay.
Lay it out real basically. Basically, Powers Boothe is in this movie, which, Powers Boothe, guys. Powers Boothe is in this movie. So, Powers Boothe is, investigating the serial killers, serial killings. I forget what the God's Hand killer,
I think,
maybe.
Yeah, okay.
Matthew McConaughey shows up in his office and is basically like, I know who the God's Hand killer is, and this tells him it's his brother, and then goes in to explain this whole story about them as kids, and their dad is played by Bill Paxton. And that's about as much as we need to get into it, because we'll be talking it more up from them, but just basically explaining their history and how he knows that his brother is the murderer based on what happened to them as kids and stuff.
For me, though, I will say this is two guys in my mind that could do no wrong, even if a movie isn't exactly great. Like, I feel like McConaughey and Paxton are always good at everything.
Yeah, I agree.
At least enjoyable, entertaining to watch. Yeah. So, and this, I love this movie, so I probably watched it once, too, so.
Oh, good. So you're definitely due for a rewatch. Yeah, absolutely. 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 Me, too. Yeah, I can't think of anything else except let's go. Let's do it.
Watch some Frailty.
Frailty. All right, we're back. We watched Frailty.
We did it.
So, were you right? Has it been, like, since it came out, since you saw it, or did it all come rushing back to you? Yeah. Like, maybe you've seen it on cable 10 times, you know? You have a fairly terrible memory for how many times you've actually seen something.
It's true. It's absolutely
true. I watched this every single day of my childhood, now that I remember it.
Watch it this morning, actually.
It turns out I was watching this morning. Mm-hmm. So, plot, first part of the movie is basically like what I said before. Powers Boothe is investigating this God's Hand killer. McConaughey shows up in his office, says, "I'm Fenton Meeks. My brother Adam is the killer."
Yep.
Says his brother called him, said some weird cryptic shit about demons, and then basically killed himself, and he stole an ambulance to, like, take his body to a rose garden where he promised he would bury his brother.
Yeah.
Kids. He's like, "I promised my brother I would bury him." And then, so he calls to check on that. That story all checks out. He calls the local sheriff. They're like, "Oh, yeah, Fenton Meeks, they just stole our ambulance," or whatever. So it all checks out. So Powers Boothe is like, "How do you know your brother's the killer? You know, what evidence do you have?" And that's when he starts to lay out this story. And so, basically, that's the point where we flash back. And the movie proper begins.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, this is all kind of set up stuff in the very beginning to kind of get us to where we need to be. But the bulk of the movie is this story that starts with in the 70s with Fenton and Adam as kids. Fenton's the older brother by a couple years.
Yeah.
And then Adam's the little brother. And their dad's a mechanic. Their mom died.
Yeah, giving birth to the baby.
The youngest one. So it's just them and their dad. Dad's a mechanic. And it's just like basically normal, happy life, you know. We only get a real quick snippet of that. You know, they just kind of show them interacting, get one little dinner. And then it's like middle of the night, the first night, Bill Paxton, who's the dad, comes rushing into the bedroom and like wakes him up to tell him he had this vision. And he was told by an angel. And I like the way they play this vision, because this first one is subtle. It's like, it's just like some light reflecting off of a bowling trophy or something.
Yeah,
you know? And he's just kind of like, and they never really show us anything. He just describes what he saw.
But he is doesn't he make the point, though, that he was awake or something like that? He's not asleep when any of this happens.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah, he does say that.
Yeah. But you're right. By, like, the third vision he has, you're like, "Oh, shit, this
is bananas."
Shit. People flying with swords.
So, yeah, absolutely.
So you're right. These visions.
Like they slow roll that.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So the way they show it, it's like you don't believe him because they want to put you in the place of Fenton, the kids, you know. Because, you know, your dad would wake you up in the middle and tell you some crazy shit like that. What? But he tells them that they're going to be, that the end of the world is coming. There's demons living among them, and God has chosen them. And this angel spoke to him and tell them that they're going to be demon slayers.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to be, basically, they're going to work as God's hands.
Yeah.
So this is where the first time Bill Paxton mentions God. And so now we get the connection why he thinks his brother is, you know,
yeah,
that's the
God
first
hand,
part
yeah.
of it. So, you know, this is going to keep Powers Boothe interested. You know?
God's hands.
I wish they didn't do it. Come back to him like the guys on those ID discovery shows. Oh.
I also like we can come back to McConaughey outlining the story he's going to tell Powers Boothe later with, like, "Oh, make sure you mention the God of Hands."
That's right, tease the God Hands bit here.
Very prepared.
So the way Bill Paxton describes it is they're basically going to have the ability to see these demons in real life, and God's going to bestow these special demon-slaying weapons on them. And that happens pretty quickly. Like the next morning they wake up and you kind of think everything's kind of normal and maybe you can, it's not, and then, you know, he's just like, "Hey, and don't tell anybody what I told you, you know, about the demon slaying and all as he drops them off to school. Oh, don't worry, I won't be telling anybody but my therapist.
For the next 15 years as we dig into this. But this must be like a new angel that Paxton gets, because this angel is on it with the assignments. I mean, he doesn't wait. It's like every day he's getting new shit from this angel.
Yeah, he's getting all sorts of messages. A lot of times,
up and comer.
Right. Yeah, a lot of times these guys get the kind of sparse messages, but no, he gets... Well, he gets his original message, and then he gets shown the weapons.
Yeah.
So he's, like, driving, and he sees a light shining down on this barn. But, like, you know, not overly done in a way that you've seen it. If you've driven across a flat area and seen a hole in the clouds and seen a beam of light, it looked realistic. It wasn't, like, you know, clearly it was, still can be played as, are we, where are we at with this? Is it real? Is dad crazy?
Yeah, yeah.
And they toe that line very well through the whole movie.
Yeah, I agree.
And it's like, it's an axe and a pair of gloves that are sitting there.
Which I do like, there's no symbolism from these angels either. It's like, here's your weapons, they're fucking weapons, here's a list.
Yeah, exactly.
We're not gonna
There's no interpretation. No. It's like, they're very straightforward with what they want him to do.
Which is good, because Paxton's character, Dad, doesn't really seem like the kind of guy that would get into the...
He doesn't want to think it out too much. He's a good worker bee.
He's good, yeah,
he is.
Good
for this job.
He is
great.
He's
a good mechanic, and he's a good demon slayer.
Good pick. They got a good pick on this guy, for sure.
So, a couple quick things about the weapons. I love that the axe is named Otis. It has Otis carved in the handle. And I saw a couple things about it. Like, it seems like mostly it was just so that you would know that it was the same axe all the time.
Yeah, I think
it was
so.
Like, you, because this was a special weapon. It's not just like he can use any axe to kill a demon. He has to have his special axe.
That's a good point.
And then we talked about the gloves, but the gloves, the whole purpose of the gloves is you kidnap the demon, and then you take off the gloves and touch them and reveal them. And when you're kidnapping them, you use the third tool, which is my favorite. Even though Otis is pretty awesome, it's just a pipe. Just a lead pipe. It looks like the pipe from Clue.
It's true.
It's just got the little twist. It's got the little end where you screw them together. It's just about this long. And I love the way Bill Paxton reveals it. He's like, I found the last one. And he comes in and he like lays it on the table and unfolds like a, it's got a wrapped in a cloth, and he like unfolds, and it's just a pipe plant. So good.
He wields
that pipe with a mighty fury though in this movie. A couple
he does.
Times.
That's he crushes it with the pipe.
He crushes them with pipe. Dad has his weapons, and then he finally gets his vision. This is the one you were talking about, where we actually see like he's under a car working, and there's some sparks going. And then the fire, like, it just kind of turns into a cathedral, and an angel with a fiery sword comes down, and the whole nine, he's just laying there. But then I love, like, the hard cut to him just being under a car, and the people working around him, like,
he's just kind of looking up.
And again, I feel like they play it just right, where it's like, there's just enough kind of sparks around and stuff, like, you could be like, is Dad just mentally ill? Like, is this schizophrenia setting in? Is this a delusion based on early onset dementia that he's having? And it's like,
absolutely.
So they play it pretty close to the vest, and they keep that. And so I like to keep that aesthetic going. So he gets his list, and I like when Adam brings his own list to his dad, and he's like written up the bullies in school who pick on him and stuff,
too.
Right? And I love the idea of Bill Paxton trying to tell his son like, no, this would be wrong to hurt people. We only slay demons. And it's like, but how can you trust the judgment of this person?
And they do a good job, because Fenton's face is just that. While you say that, dude, he's just like, this is fucking bananas.
The hypocrisy of what you are saying to this kid. Like, and it's like, Fenton wants to, Fenton wants to leave, he wants to run away, but Adam doesn't, and he doesn't want to leave Adam, and so there's a constant struggle going on there. So Dad brings home the first demon. It's a lady.
Yeah. A nurse? Is she like a nurse?
She's wearing all white. I think she's supposed to be a nurse. It's the 70s, so I think, you know, that's how they represented nurses in the 70s. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, full-on murders her in front of the the kids. But this is the first time we see the where Howie reveals where he takes the gloves off. He touches them. Great reacting by Bill here. he's getting a lot of visions and stuff. Now, we're not seeing anything, you know, obviously. We don't see it. And Fenton says he doesn't see it, and Adam says he does.
But we know Adam has told lies, so he's unreliable. Exactly.
They do a good job of setting up his list.
Yeah.
That he's eager to please. He wants to be like his dad. So they're on both sides of the fence here as far as that goes. After Fenton tries to get Adam to run away with him again and tells him he's being brainwashed and stuff, then all of a sudden Bill Paxton has another vision. This is always something that I find suspicious. This is like in the Mormon church when the guy lost the plates. He's like, oh, well, I'll just translate them. They're going to be slightly different than they were the first time. It's like, oh, all of a sudden the angel had to pipe in a new set of rules because he heard about what you were saying. It's like, it's just a little suspicious. It's just kind of like...
Yeah, very suspicious here.
All of a sudden, you found out that now you get a new vision from an angel who's telling you something you don't want to hear about me. Mm-hmm. And you don't want to believe it. So we got to believe that at this point, the angels are telling him Fenton's a demon.
Yeah, that's what you're leading to believe. Right. Like, I don't want... He doesn't tell him. He's like, I don't want to say it.
No, he doesn't want to say it. He's like, I'm not going to say it because I don't believe it. But he does set him on some penance.
Yeah.
And he gets him out digging this gigantic pit, this huge hole. Which, I will say, accurate dad punishment. When you're a teenager, you know, if your dad's looking to find a way to punish you, manual labor is a great one.
It's
a really great one. I remember a buddy of mine, his dad had him move a pile of bricks. Just had this
back
big pile of bricks, had to move it across the yard, and once it was all stacked, had to move it back. I was like, that's brutal. My dad just beat me, so I was lucky.
See, that's nice. It's quick, it's over.
Right, and then when it was over, he kicked me out so he could go out drinking. It's like, get out of here. He starts digging the hole as kind of penance. He gets the hole dug. They build a shed over the hole. They bring another demon in. But this time, Fenton's had enough. He can't. Because this is where Bill Paxton's going to make him do the killing.
Yeah,
he's got the axe and everything. And Fenton drops it, and he runs off, and he goes to the sheriff, and he gets the sheriff. And now, we've seen adults not believe kids before in movies. But I really feel like this sheriff has an unreasonable amount of, like, boys will be boys. And, hey, get your... Because, like, of course he doesn't believe him, and he takes him back to Bill Paxton. But then Bill Paxton is acting super hinky.
He's really hinky.
Yeah, and then, like... And the kid is really insistent. Like, a lot of these... If that was a lie, as soon as you took him back to his dad and confront him in front of his dad, he'd buckle.
Yeah, crying, bawling, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Fenton is super insistent, and still he doesn't. But he's insistent enough that they do eventually get... And I love that moment that Bill Paxton has where he says... he looks at me, he's like, does it have to be done?
Yeah.
And he's basically saying to Fenton, it's like, if you push this any farther, you know I'm going to have to kill this guy.
Yeah. Just because I already told him. But did he have to kill him, do you think? Because we do get to the point where it seems like the sheriff has bought Bill Paxton's story. Do you think he's going to check the Rose Garden?
They go down to the basement, down to the pit.
Mm-hmm.
The guy who was in the pit's gone. Nothing in the pit. The sheriff is like done with this. He's like, I've seen enough.
Yeah.
I'm sick of this. I've gone farther. And just as he's going up the stairs, Fenton's like, I can show you where the bodies are buried, the Rose Garden. And he makes a look. He hesitates, he looks, but he never confirms or denies. And he goes up out of frame up the steps, and then you just hear the wet smack of an axe, and he comes tumbling back down, and that's it. And then I love how broken up Bill Paxton is.
Oh, so great.
So
throws
this
up.
Is such a great, and just like openly weeping about how he had to kill a man, and like, Fenton, you made me do this.
Mm-hmm.
You killed this man because of your lack of faith and everything. And this is where we get into the real hardcore child torture shit, because he puts Fenton in the pit under the shed.
He gives him the box. He gives him solitary for a week.
Yeah, a week
at first
with water, and then he says a week. I do love it though, because he goes a whole week and he comes back and he's like, "Have you found God?" And Fenton, and I love the little kid just looks up and he's all broken. He's like, there is no God. Paxton just slams the door, and then he says he loses count of the days after that.
Yeah.
So who knows how long he had him in there in solitary. That's crazy. Sip of water a day and shit. And literally, Fenton says, I went insane. I go insane. I saw God. And they basically... He stops responding because he's dying, you know, and they bring him out and they kind of get him back and he tells his dad that he saw God and he got his message. And I love the little, they're still playing up the big brother, little brother thing, and the family dynamic here is done so well where he's like, Adam's mad that Fenton got to see God and all he's ever seen are demons. He's like, all I ever get to see are demons. Man. So good. I love it. After Fenton comes out of his out of the pit and he says he saw God and he has his mission, he knows what he has to do, you know, they go to get his first demon. And you noted this guy is the worst at not seeming like a demon.
Yeah.
Like, you had the nurse, you had the old man, and then I forget which is the one when the sheriff, it's just like a kid. It's like a college
kid.
We don't know much, we don't see much of that one. But this guy is like a full-on, looks like a full-on crazy person. He's screaming at Senates and his wife and shit.
It's like Men in Black when those people are trying to pretend like they're not alien, but it's not working because he's just kind of like uncomfortable in his skin almost.
Yeah, absolutely. So they get him and they take him down to the pit. And Fenton's gonna, he's got the axe, he's gonna kill him, and he says, I'm ready to fulfill my destiny. And I don't know about you, but did you get that Kylo Ren vibe? Like the whole thing, like, there's something I have to do, but I don't know if I can. You know?
I didn't even think about that.
And then he does. He nails Bill Paxton in the chest with the axe. Boom! Kills Dad.
Yeah. Adam does the Chewie roar.
And then Adam screams. And then this is maybe one of the best jump scares in a movie. You know, we've all been conditioned in the last couple years. The jump scares are getting really overused.
Mm-hmm.
Where... like, it's not even something, it's just, they drop out the sound, and then a loud noise. It's not even a real thing that happens.
Yeah, it's
You're just conditioned.
Music, yeah.
Your body is conditioned to feel this way. This was a excellent, legit, out of nowhere, Carrie's hand coming up from the grave, jump scare, when, he kills Bill Paxton. It's this shocking moment. We're all like, oh my God. And then he goes over to the guy on the ground to pull the tape off, and as soon as he pulls the tape off the guy's mouth, the guy's like, no! And Adam comes running up, just, and buries the axe in the dude. And I mean, the sight of a small child wielding an axe with that much anger in his face is terrifying.
Yeah, anytime. It just burns in your mind for some
exactly,
reason.
Exactly,
you know?
Absolutely. It's like Baby Gage in Pet Cemetery. Like, I just can't.
So true.
So I think that jump scare was really excellent and well utilized. I need to shout that out because in this era of horror movies, we're over the breaking point with that now.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a really good utilization. We're finishing up this obviously at this point in the story, Powers Boothe is like, what the fuck? You know? Because, McConaughey's been telling him all this, and he's telling him how me and Adam buried the body, and then I told Adam, if you ever have to slay me, bury me here in the Rose Garden.
But.
And Powers Boothe's like, now wait, but wait, you're telling me that that we're here to get Adam from the Rose Garden, that he said to bury him. He's like, it doesn't make sense, but it does if the man in front of you is Adam Meeks. Oh, snap.
The haircuts don't lie.
That's right.
The blonde, beautiful hair boy.
The locks of Adam, of little Adam, grew up into Matthew McConaughey. So we twist the whole story. You thought you've been hearing the narrative from Fenton, but we've actually been hearing it as told by Adam, the believer. So it kind of turns a little bit everything we've seen now from Fenton, and specifically the parts of him and being in the shed.
Exactly, true.
And like what happened in there and like how his mind was broken.
We are to believe, because we do know now at the end that demons are real. Adam is sent to fight him. Do we believe Denton was always a demon? Is there a point? Because we know Adam's only speculating what's going on through his mind down when he's in that basement. He has no idea.
This is exactly what I wanted to talk about.
Okay.
So, I have a couple things here we can get into. we do get the real, like, we see Adam, when Adam's telling Powers Boothe, and he's like, I'm Adam, I did see the demon every time. We do some flashbacks, and we show when Bill Paxton puts his hand on people, and he does all that great reacting, flashes of their crimes, and their faces get kind of messed up and demonic, kind of a devil's advocate style, you know, yeah. A little creepy. So we see all that. So we know that Adam thinks it's real. And I was also thinking about, you were talking about Fenton, like, when he's trying to dissuade Adam and tell Adam that it's not true, is he doing that knowingly as a demon?
Exactly.
Is the demon out in him? The other aspect of this is, through systematic abuse and torture, did Bill Paxton break Fenton's spirit and create a monster, and also systematically brainwash his own son with his own psychosis and regenerate that? And so it could all still be is there a chance there are no demons?
I was thinking that same thing. The very last scene, if you change guys that go to see Matthew McConaughey, I think you can get away with wondering that. But I think the fact that the guy that he meets when he goes to the FBI building is the same guy who comes to the sheriff's station and doesn't remember Matthew McConaughey right. from meeting him the day before, I think that scene, you can say it. With that scene, it's hard to say, because I was right there with you. I was thinking, wait a second, Adam is still crazy. Bill Paxton was crazy. Denton was broken and became a serial killer down in that shed.
Absolutely.
There are no demons.
Absolutely.
It's a family of serial killers. But that guy's an FBI agent, and the fact that an FBI agent wouldn't remember seeing a guy the day before.
And I think you're right, and I think you nailed it. There's a little, just enough supernatural bent to push it over into the reality, because when Adam, posing as Fenton, comes to the FBI building, the security cameras pick him up, but they're distorted in just a way that always covers his face.
Yeah.
And the FBI agent who met him, like you talked about, can't remember him. He just, when he tries to remember him, he has a blank spot, and he goes back to town, and then we have one final reveal that Adam is the sheriff of this town.
And I would have bought the tape if you would have just gave me the tape and just had another
that
guy
could
go.
Have been just a distortion,
I would have
yeah.
still finish this movie going.
But the fact that they
real?
Had met face to face, and then he doesn't remember, and then they do the great, he shakes his hand and he's like, "You're a good man." such a great
yeah,
little moment.
Good.
So I agree. I think they give you just enough. But I also think that it's open enough to interpretation that if you wanted to believe the other way, I wouldn't fault you for that.
Yeah,
I think so.
I would let it ride. He's a good man, but he's just a dolt because he met you right. yesterday and didn't remember.
We said we were going to talk about the kids for Character Corner. Was there anybody else that you wanted to shout out besides the kids?
Maybe a little Powers Boothe question for you that I thought of before it started, but it actually came up organically while we were talking. When they flash back to Powers Boothe, you get some sweet burns to know that you're dealing with 70s Boothe.
Yeah, it's supposed to be back in the 70s.
But I ask you, what is your favorite Powers Boothe facial hair combination? Because this man can transform with his facial hair. Will you choose the Baron, and I'll give you the burns, the just stash, or the full beard and come down Powers Boothe?
I gotta go my first love, my first Powers Boothe love, Tombstone. Curly Bill Bronson. So you got not only the big handlebar, but then the little black soul patch too. Little black soul patch.
A little extra something so we know you're evil. That's how you tell the bad guys from the good
Kurt Russell only has the handlebar.
Only handlebar. You get the soul patch and the handlebar, bad guy.
And then Morgan and Doc Holliday both do thin mustaches. So I like all types of mustaches represented in Tombstone, by the way.
Except for we never get the Hitler stash in any way.
No.
Unfortunately, I'd like to see that in a non. It can't happen, right?
He ruined it. He ruined that, and he ruined the name Adolf. You can't name somebody Adolf, and you can't have that little mustache.
That'll be the greatest man that ever lives. The guy named Adolf,
so great.
Who runs the stash, who is so on the other side, is such a great dude that everyone's like.
Dispels so many myths.
Yeah. It'll be like 200 years from now, they'll be like, wow, this guy's actually pretty great dude.
Absolutely.
He'll probably be a fucking athlete or something like that. He'll be like The Rock.
But yeah, Powers Boothe is great. Great facial hair. I agree. Sideburns were one thing, but you should have used a mustache. It was the 70s. Perfect time for a mustache. Put a mustache on his flashback. All right, so let's talk about the kids. Jeffrey Sumter played young Adam, who the meatier part of the Adam role comes from the reveal and Matthew McConaughey. Mm-hmm. So he kind of just has the more childlike of the two child roles.
Yeah.
He's still real good. He's real good in the movie. Went on to become quite the hunk we saw on IMDb. Good-looking kid. Good Lord.
Oh, yeah. Did a little Friday Night Lights there, so good for him.
Little Bill Paxton connection. Like, tacitly. He was in Into the Storm, which, as far as I know, is the only other big-budget tornado movie that ever was released besides Twister.
Well, I needed
didn't
one.
Didn't do as well. Was not as good as not as well received as Twister, no. But I just thought that was interesting. I was like, oh, hey. Little connector there.
Is Twister the best weather catastrophe movie or most popular weather catastrophe movie? We've had the ones.
I was actually having this discussion with my wife because I think, you know, we had the ones in the 70s, like Towering Inferno,
yeah,
and Earthquake and Poseidon Adventure, stuff like that. But then we really didn't get back into disaster movies until Independence Day, which is really an invasion movie, but because of the mass destruction in it, that's what got emulated in future, and then, like, in the next couple years, when you had Dante's Peak Volcano, you had Armageddon and Deep Impact, Twister, I can't remember, do we have some other ones? I guess that's most of them. Twister was the only one that I felt Twister and Dante's Peak felt the most realistic out of all those.
Well, it's a smaller stage. I mean,
they were the ones that were trying the hardest to kind of, even though they're both wildly unrealistic, they were both trying the hardest to seem realistic.
Agreed.
I love Twister.
I like it because I think you didn't have to go to, like, they're not saving the world in Twister, you know what I mean? It's just a couple scientists doing their thing, whereas those other movies you mentioned, once we had Independence Day, it was like, if it's not threatening the human race, we don't give a fuck anymore.
Yeah, exactly. I agree with that.
Which Pratt might still carry on today. I don't usually give a shit about any movie unless everyone I know is in danger from
the
bad guy.
The stakes
mean?
Yeah, well, but I think the flip side of that is the little movies, the Oscar movies, like stuff like Whiplash, where the stakes are so small, but the movie is just so well acted and written that it doesn't matter.
Nope, it doesn't. No, I don't even. Those don't even count as real movies to me, unless there's some sort of earth-ending event. It's not really. It's not worth my time.
Is there a sky beam? Did a beam shoot up in the sky and open a portal? Is an alien force coming through it? And then I don't give a fuck.
Is anybody wearing, like, armor or have magical powers? I don't give a shit.
Yeah,
man,
no.
You know what I mean?
You got nothing for me.
This movie counts because technically they do say the word Armageddon once.
Ooh, that's true.
So it does count as a movie. Welcome to the new DVD bunker. Does this count as a movie? Under Matt's ridiculous standards.
Well, I was wondering if we were going to do goodbye versus goodbye. Now we can just be like, is this a real movie? Phew, it is. Oh, thank goodness. Yeah. Thank goodness.
They said Armageddon at least once.
Now, we didn't even talk. We still got to talk about Matt O'Leary.
Okay.
He played young Fenton. And I think he has the hardest role in the whole movie. I mean, he's got the most to do, and so I got to give it up to him. Really solid performance. And both these guys actually went on to have fairly... They're both still working. They both work a lot. I did pick out a couple... Matt O'Leary was in Death Sentence with Kevin Bacon.
Okay.
And the movie, it's kind of a revenge movie. But it's a really good revenge movie that doesn't glamorize revenge, which I like. I like that. And he was also in Brick, which is the first movie by Rian Johnson, spelled R-I-A-N, Rian Johnson, who did Looper and is doing Episode 8, Star Wars Episode 8.
Okay.
I'm not a fan of Brick or Looper, so I've really got my fingers crossed for Episode 8.
I've never seen Brick. I did like Looper.
Did you like Looper?
I like any time that they take somebody and try to make them look more like Bruce Willis. Also, there was serious possibilities that the world could end in that movie.
That's true. So it
automatically classic.
Instant classic.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I think we've talked about enough about Frailty. Do you have anything else we haven't covered? Pretty extensive.
No, I like this. I love the reveal. I always, for a guy that's a non-believer, I always am obsessed with these angels versus demon movies.
Yeah.
Like, it's almost like if I wanted it to be true, that's what the reality I would want to be true, where I'm locked in an actual battle against evil.
Exactly.
That's the only way I'm going for
just
it.
Just this kind of, like, low level, he's watching, and maybe something will happen. That's not good enough for me. I need full-on angels and demons waging war on the planet Earth.
And you can't code it in some way where by doing good deeds, I'm fighting the devil.
Yeah.
No, someone has to drop, like, a sword, a hammer, someone has to fly down a guy with a cool beard, has to fly down
with
a flaming
sword.
Sword. Lord. You know how much time I spend underneath cars
waiting for that to happen?
For a fucking... I have sparks flying all around me. You know, it's when I spend on sparklers just to fucking put them on my hands while I'm looking because I thought maybe I'm missing
sparks.
Get them
way out in your peripheral vision.
Yeah.
And I've paid
to go into actual garages to lay underneath because I thought maybe I need to recreate that. No, it hasn't happened.
Well, and think of all the time you've wasted investigating barns that light was shining down on just over and over again. Stopping at places. Do you mind if I go and look in your barn?
The legal fees I've paid for trespassing and just arrests for breaking and entering. Just the axes on my walls that I've stolen.
All right, so to me, I think it goes without saying this is a goodbye. Yeah. I mean, even if we'd end up doing this on the bunker, it would have been because I wanted to show it to the world and get more of the word out about it. I'm glad we got to do that. I'm sorry for the reason we did that. You know,
yeah, it's a
Bill Paxton is that's a tragic loss. All I could think about is the roles that we got robbed of. Like, how many great roles he was still going to do.
Yep.
You know, there was so much, you know, time for him. I heard a great quote, Action Movie Anatomy. I'm a big fan on the Popcorn Talk Network. Check those guys out. They were doing a tribute. They have a tribute episode up to Bill Paxton. Go watch them if you've watched this. But there was a quote from James Cameron, and I forget the whole thing, but part of it was he referred to Bill Paxton as an actor in his prime. And I love the idea that a guy of James Cameron's caliber looked at 61-year-old Bill Paxton and was like, that dude's still got a lot to give us.
Damn, yeah,
that's
awesome.
And that's the truth. That's the truth.
That's a good way to put it, man.
So let us know in the comments, like, you know, chat up about Bill Paxton. Find us on Twitter, at Hercules.
At the Drunksman.
Hashtag DVD Bunker. Talk about Bill Paxton. Talk about any of our previous episodes. Like this video. Subscribe to the TUFF channel. Lots of great content all the time. BFF, Odd Shape Panel, Fan Friction. It's great. We're having a good time.
Awesome.
All right. Thank you, Bill Paxton.
Thanks,
bye.
Bill. Bye. Thank you.